The London borough of Bexley, situated on the outskirts of southeast London, provides an intriguing contrast between town and country and has a rich heritage which is well documented and recorded. This programme does not attempt to be a comprehensive history of the area. It is more a magazine of the past, a collection of unique cinefilms and photographs from widely differing sources, which provide an opportunity to reflect on long-forgotten images captured by local filmmakers and photographers. At 12:30 on the 17th of July 1912, council dignitaries, special guests and members of the public services assembled at the borough offices and proceeded to march to the marketplace in Bexley Heath. In the procession were the council leaders, who had taken a decision that Bexley Heath would honour its new king, George V, with a permanent memorial in the form of a clock tower, to be built in the marketplace on the Broadway. The task of designing the clock tower was given to Walter Epps, his fee the princely sum of £590. Work commenced in November 1911, and by July 1912 it was ready to be unveiled to the public. As the crowd gathered in the marketplace and the time approached 1 p.m, Councillor Reed gave an address before turning to face the tower and inserting a commemorative silver key specially made for the occasion. As he did so, he declared, "This coronation memorial clock is now open." A roar of three cheers then erupted from the crowd. 2 years later, Bexley, along with the rest of the country, was at war. The local area contributed much to the war effort, chiefly through its many munition factories. Troops such as these were billeted across the borough to protect the factories. These recruits would originally have been part of the 9th Kent Volunteers, many of whom came from the Welling and Bexley area, although during the war they served as the 8th London Howitzer Brigade. This picture is of 32 Squadron RAF, based at Saint-Paul in France during 1918. Lord Glentworth, standing forth from the left, was the son of Lady Limerick, who was the owner of Hall Place in Bexley. In Sidcup, Queen Mary's Hospital housed many Allied wounded soldiers from the front, and the hospital gained a worldwide reputation for its work in plastic surgery. Throughout the war, the sight of Zeppelins over Bexley became quite common as they travelled up the Thames towards central London. When the war ended, people took to the streets and celebrated. Here we see a procession in Crayford High Street, and the people of Welling took time out to lavishly decorate this victory tramcar. Arriving at the Princess's Theatre in Crayford are the Metropolitan Police to perform in front of an eagerly awaiting audience. The Princess's was opened on the 26th of July 1916 on the waterside in Crayford. The war had seen an influx of workers into the area to work in its many munition factories. Many were employed by Vickers, and as the demand for war production increased, so did the number of workers. This influx began to place a great strain on the limited amenities of the rural community, so Vickers decided to ease the burden by sponsoring the building of a new theatre. Later that year, tragedy was to strike the community when sadly the acclaimed theatre burnt down, but Vickers once again saved the day, enabling it to be completely rebuilt and go on to become a much-loved local amenity. The Metropolitan Police were star billing this day and treated the audience to a popular entertainment show of that era, the Minstrel Show. On the corner of Oaklands Road, a landmark that had stood on the horizon overlooking Bexley Heath for nearly 100 years was about to disappear. The steeple of the former Chapel of Ease had stood alone long after its chapel had been demolished. When it was built in 1835, the Chapel of Ease was the first Anglican church in Bexley Heath. It was so important to the Anglican community that the Archbishop of Canterbury laid the foundation stone, and when it was completed, over 3,000 people attended its opening. Later, 294 children took part in a procession which ended with tea in the market house. The steeple was added when the chapel was later extended in 1851. In 1877, the chapel was demolished to make way for Christ Church, which still stands today. All that remained of the original chapel was its steeple, until it was demolished in 1929. From a vantage point at the top of the steeple, we get a view of Bexley Heath prior to the rapid building work that took place in the 1930s. Using huge bags to cover the trees and bushes, larvae of many rare and attractive species of butterflies were nurtured by Leonard W. Newman. He had started this remarkable local enterprise at Salisbury Road in Bexley in 1905. The butterflies were often purchased by zookeepers, collectors, and laboratories. After his death in 1947, his son, L. Hugh Newman, who became a well-known broadcaster and natural history writer, carried on his work. The butterfly farm lasted for 61 years and achieved an international reputation. On Easter Monday, 1925, Her Royal Highness, the Princess Royal, Mary, the daughter of George V, arrived at Danson Mansion and Park. The park had been bought in 1924 by the Bexley Urban District Council for £16,000 and was heralded as the new Lung for London, providing further open spaces for its people. The Princess had been invited to perform the official opening. Sitting on a raised platform next to the Chairman of the Council, she was entertained by Miss Florence Hyde, who gave a rousing rendition of Land of Hope and Glory. On a wet and blustery day, many people had braved the elements to witness the ceremony and hopefully catch a closer glimpse of the Princess. The Princess was also given a tour of the estate, meeting local dignitaries, estate workers, and acknowledging the cheers from the crowd. Before leaving, she was presented with a further bouquet of flowers and given a rousing send-off. The Morris Wheeler gates marked the entrance to Danson Park. They were formally opened in 1929 by the Lord Mayor of London, Sir Kynaston Studd. Danson Park, built in 1759, is set in 210 acres of parkland, and at the time was the second largest open space in London. Graced by many varieties of handsome trees, a delightful lake, a Georgian mansion, an old world garden, and acres of meadowland, the park was later developed for the leisure time pursuits of its ratepayers. The council provided football pitches, tennis courts, bowling greens, and continued to develop the park throughout this century. In 1964, a new boathouse and cafe was added. As the century progressed, the mansion began to fall into decay amidst great public criticism. Eventually, the council came to an agreement with English Heritage, and now fully restored, the mansion stands once again as one of the finest 18th century houses in southeast London. In 1936, Councillor A.G. Williams officially opened a popular new addition to Danson Park, an open-air swimming pool. The opening was followed by a swimming gala that featured ladies' teams from Bromley, Greenwich, Woolwich and Ladywell, and the men from Greenwich, Erith and a local firm, Siemens. During the gala, the crowds were treated to displays of diving, ornamental swimming and floating that were followed by a polo match between Woolwich and Plumstead. Amongst the swimmers were J.G. Davis, who had represented England in the recent Empire Games, and Miss M.K. Jeffrey, who had been selected to swim for England at what was to become the now infamous 1936 Berlin Olympic Games. Following the abdication of Edward VIII, his brother George VI, the father of our present Queen, was crowned on the 12th of May 1937. The people of the borough were not ones to miss out on an excuse for a celebration, and duly obliged. All manner of coronation celebrations were held throughout the borough, from Sidcup to Crayford, where decorations, bunting, street parties, and festivities were the order of the day. Here in Bexley Heath, a procession winds its way down the Broadway. A bazaar is opened at Belvedere. And street parties such as this one in Stapley Road, Belvedere, were held across the borough. On the morning of the 30th of September 1937, Bexley celebrated the granting of its charter of incorporation by the new king, George VI. At Danson Park, a crowd eagerly awaited the arrival of the main procession of civic leaders and guests as they prepared to leave the mansion to head for the enclosure in the park. Earlier, the procession had left the council offices at Highland Road en route to Danson, stopping at the War Memorial to lay wreaths and to plant a tree near the entrance to the Danson mansion. Amidst the civic pomp and ceremony, a telegraph was sent to the king, conveying the thanks and loyalty of the Bexley townspeople. After the formalities ended, the large crowd enjoyed a programme of entertainment that included a fair, demonstrations of play leadership by local children, community singing, dancing, and finally, a grand firework display. What little we know of this film suggests that Sidcup was celebrating the coronation of George VI, possibly at the Green. A fancy dress parade depicting many characters from English history was the highlight of the festivities. One particular entrant displayed his enthusiasm for the new king. Members of the local volunteer services and many youth organisations were on parade. Amidst such pomp and ceremony, the May Queen was crowned. And the crowd was later treated to a number of events, including dancing around the Maypole. But the festivities were taking place amidst rising concern over events unfolding in Europe. Before long, the people of Bexley were to face a Second World War. Being so close to the Royal Arsenal and the River Thames, it was perhaps inevitable that the local area would bear the brunt of the Blitz, as these photographs testify. At the time, the authorities were concerned that the filming of actual bomb damage could provide the Germans with evidence of how successful their bombing raids were. As a result, any film that was taken was used to show the vital role the volunteer services played. To ensure that they could respond to any situation, gas exercises such as these outside Bachelors, the fishmongers in Bexley Heath's Pickford Lane, were carried out. There was also an opportunity to tell people how best to deal with incendiary devices. The bombing meant that persuading everyone to use the air raid shelters, such as this one in Welling, was very important. Throughout the Blitz, the dedicated men and women of the ARP and the Home Guard worked with the people of the borough to maintain a well-organized schedule of air raid practices to keep them on their toes. East Wickham House provided an ideal venue for staging exercises in putting out fires and rescuing people from burning buildings. It seems so calm and straightforward, and the dummy would not have minded a few bumps along the way. And all the practice was appreciated when the constant air raids placed the area's volunteer services at full stretch. Between September 1939 and May 1945, the borough had over 4,800 alerts, the majority of which occurred during the Blitz itself. And when the Germans eventually replaced their bombers with flying bombs, there were 96 reported incidents. Earlier in our film sequence, we saw how to deal with incendiary bombs. And during this period, the volunteer services dealt with over 54,000 such devices. And with a further 2,400 high explosive devices to deal with, the value of their unstinting work can never be underestimated. Such was the scale of the human casualties that 500 lost their lives and over 5,000 were injured. After the war, the borough had to count the cost of rebuilding as they coped with the massive scale of damage caused to its properties. In all, over 92,000 houses were damaged, of which 60,000 were in the Bexley district. Over 5,000 properties had to be replaced or required major repairs, so the cost was inevitably going to be high. At the Odeon in Welling, the arrival of the First Lord of the Admiralty and local MP, Mr. A.V. Alexander, and the Mayor of Bexley, Alderman Ashmore, signalled the start of Warship Week in March 1942. A week of intense fundraising with parades and local events raised the enormous total of £210,000, and in doing so, helped the borough to adopt the warship HMS Lance. The highlight of the week was a parade with many of the branches of the armed services, including the Navy, the volunteer services, and youth organizations. The parade started in the Broadway and proceeded to Danson Mead, Parkview Road, and finally Welling Corner. Despite Hitler's best efforts to disrupt life in Bexley, instances such as these typified the borough's bulldog spirit. To ensure his customers got their meat rations, Sullivan's the Butchers in Blackfen set up outdoors after the shop suffered bomb damage. And no one was going to stop Bill Phipps, W. Scarborough, and Princess the Horse from delivering the Daily Pinter, unexploded bomb or not. When victory finally came and the threat to the nation was lifted, the people of the borough once more took to the streets and celebrated together. From a street party in Barnfield Road, Belvedere, despite rationing still being in force, there seemed to be plenty on the tables. Sidcup celebrated with a VE Day parade. In Appledore Avenue, Barnhurst, the residents stood in front of the remains of their demolished houses, being careful not to fall into a 20-foot bomb crater nearby. At the north front of Danson Mansion, 13-year-old Miss Jean Owen is arriving to receive her mayoral chains of office. Miss Owen was accorded the honour of being the youngest person ever to be nominated mayoress. This honour was very fitting, because the first woman mayor of Bexley, Mrs. E. Boswell, had nominated her for the role. The new mayor chose Miss Owen to be her representative for youth during her year of office. The film also shows fascinating footage of the interior of Danson Mansion, including the organ that is now located at Hall Place. The River Thames is often portrayed as a peaceful and placid river on a hot summer's day. However, it can be a destructive force if the winter is more severe than usual. In 1953, a combination of spring or surge tide and high winds caused the Thames to burst its banks, and places like Erith and Belvedere suffered more than most. Along the banks of the Thames, 300 were to lose their lives in a week of devastation. Throughout the flooded areas, over 10,000 servicemen were employed to try and repair the river's damaged defences. Belvedere and its station took the brunt of the floods, and in Lower Road and Piccadilly Street, the water was knee-deep. Despite deep flooding in Piccadilly Street and Station Road, non-mechanical and mechanical transport made important efforts to overcome the obstacles. But the flood victims did receive some cheer as their new Queen Elizabeth called to visit them. Councillor Mrs. H. Jerome and the Reverend J.J. Brown welcomed her before she went on to meet the victims at first hand, accompanied by the borough engineer, Mr. J.N. Clayton. Over the years, flooding continued to be a hazard for the area, until the London flood barriers were completed in 1982. These pictures of flooding in 1958 are a further reminder of how destructive the Thames can be. But to some, it was an opportunity for idle fun, as this boy clearly shows outside the Vickers factory gate in Crayford, whilst others struggled to carry on or took their hand in helping out. In 1953, the borough had cause to celebrate in honour of the young Queen Elizabeth. If you couldn't get into central London, there were plenty of activities taking place locally. The borough was brightly decorated, and there were many street parties, such as this one in Betcham Road. Or you could have gone to a fancy dress party at Royal Park Riverside. Crayford celebrated by holding a carnival procession. May Queen at the Green, Falconwood, provided a fitting substitute for the new Queen. As the festivities drew to a close, the clock tower was suitably lit up to provide a fitting closing picture. Earlier in the programme, we saw the charter celebrations of 1937. 25 years on, in 1962, Bexley Heath had changed quite dramatically, although the clock tower continued to take centre stage. Much of the Charter Jubilee celebrations centered around the service of commemoration and thanksgiving conducted at Christchurch on Sunday, the 14th of October. However, there were ample opportunities to enjoy oneself away from the civic pomp. And it is interesting to compare some of the events that took place in 1962 with those of 1937. The winner of the fancy dress competition was a very fragile-looking egg. Our journey through Erith begins at the riverside and the old police station, quickly followed by two of the better-known public houses in the area. A prominent place in the memories of this era is taken by Mitchell's, the home of quality, located at the corner of the High Street and Pier Road. The town's biggest and best-loved store managed to survive for 150 years in various guises. It even got through the war. But finally, its doors closed forever in October 1961, guarded only by the shuttered windows until it was finally demolished in 1966. Lesness Abbey has remained much the same since the 12th century. It was built by Richard de Lucy as a penance for his involvement in the murder of Thomas à Becket in Canterbury Cathedral in 1170. These ruins, set amid a large area of grassland, illustrate clearly the layout of an Augustinian monastery. Erith Playhouse is another survivor, although not for as long. It is often said that the vault underneath the playhouse was originally a smuggler's haunt. As the bus makes its way up Friday Hill, the camera moves up Collier's Lane and out to the marshland area beyond Erith, where further towards Greenwich, the new riverside town of Thamesmead was soon to be built. Following the Jacob's Biscuit van, our journey takes us to Picardy Street, where the new flats show the redevelopment of the area after it was damaged during the Blitz. The Royal Arsenal Co-op on Avenue Road provides a backdrop to images that represent an interesting mix of the old and new. Two of Erith's well-known buildings are the Odeon and Erith Picture House. And yet, even newer means of transport could not escape the onset of progress as the trolleybus service seen outside the council offices and the library made its last journey on March the 3rd, 1959. The riverside at Crayford provides a backbone to the community. The town dates back to the Saxon period. And these scenes, looking up the High Street towards St. Paulinus, with the bare and ragged staff public house to the left, suggest a more sedate and calm country town, not in keeping with its highly industrialized status. Whilst commuters flit between suburbs and the city, we're reminded of Crayford's own industrial heritage. The earliest was the textile industry, responsible for bringing the first influx of workers into the area. Yet the predominant industry was munitions, particularly at Vickers. The history of the Vickers Crayford Works dates from the early years of this century, but the First World War brought a dramatic increase in its production. Before 1914, less than 350 people worked at the factory, but by the end of the war,